should be, because that's where they came from. They were all up there on both sides. They were on both sides, so they should be okay.
I would just open one. I'm trying to open some here so that I've got a lot of problems.
I know. If you... Elder. You may have to use the choir loft on the right side over there if you have to. I know that's not good for seating for viewing, but if you have to, you have to. You ready, Ricky? Congregation, please rise. Go ahead, Elder. To everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to love, a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. This afternoon, on behalf of the New Haven leadership team, the New Haven board members, and New Haven family, I welcome you here as we celebrate the life of Brother Ernesto Ernie McDonald. We'd invite you at this time to remain standing, but I invite the family to be seated, as Sister Amanda Noel will lead us in our opening hymn.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior season, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Heavenly Father and mighty God, as we come into this place, Lord, we gather in sorrow because we've lost a brother, a father, a husband, a son. And yet, Father, we're gathered in this place because we are also grateful and thankful for the time that you gave us. That son, that brother, that husband, and that father. Amen. And Father, as we're here, we ask that your presence would fill this place. I especially ask, Father God, that your presence would surround the family members, that your Holy Spirit would draw near and comfort them in ways that only you can.
Amen.
And as we feel the loss this afternoon, Father, I pray that you would also bring back the pleasant memories. Bring back the laughter and the joy. Bring back the assurance that as much as we loved him, he loved us as well. Father, we ask these things because you are the great healer, the great physician, and today especially we need you to be the great comforter, binding our hearts together and filling us with hope of your soon return. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Once again, I have the pleasure and responsibility of welcoming every one of you here on behalf of New Haven. Sister McDonald and family, we shed tears with you. We feel the loss with you. And family members, as I mentioned earlier, if there's anything New Haven can do, please don't feel hesitant to reach out and to call. It may be, you may think it is insignificant, but nothing is too insignificant in these days to come. So please don't let us pass you by. New Haven family members, I encourage you, those of you that have contact with this family in any way, please reach out during these times, not just today, but on Monday, but on Tuesday, on Wednesday, and even a week and 2 weeks after. A powerful prayer, a thinking of you, can do this family well in the days to come. I know many of the family members may have traveled. I do want to give special shout out to Jonathan. It's good to see you, man. Jonathan is a friend of mine, dear and dear. And it's good to have you home, even under these circumstances. For those who are participating in the program, it will go and proceed as followed without being announced. So please, if you notice where you are ministering this afternoon, please move expediently at that time. And with that, I invite Sister Shanika to bring us our scripture.
Hello, everyone.
today's scripture will be taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. I will read in your hearing. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so that you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. So encourage each other with these words.
Your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. Your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. Till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest times, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that sing of the goodness of God.
Family has asked that the tributes be limited to those in the program, but I do want the family members to turn around and observe New Haven for just a moment, because this is as full as we have been since COVID raised its ugly head a couple years ago. And it's this full because, family, these people love you, they loved Ernie, and they're here to support you during this challenging time. So even though they may not get to verbally state it this afternoon, know that they have him and you in their hearts. At this time, I'll invite Brother Darren to begin the tributes as listed in the program, followed Darren Trimmingham, followed by Devon Thomas, Janelle Benoit, and Sheena Charles.
Gentlemen, this is kind of tough. I'm just going to say how I knew Ernie. Ernie was a man who was always in great spirits. His favorite slogan was, "What's going on?" Every time he saw me, every time he saw anybody for that matter, always showing love anytime and every time that I saw him. To some, they might not know, but Ernie could cook a wicked oxtail. I often remember Ernie always checking on his cousin Sam, who I have the pleasure of calling my wife, all the time at her job and always being a protector to her when I'm not around. Even her dropping her home from the supermarket that's only a couple feet away. He was always a lover. I mean, you know, he was just a loving person. That's mostly what I remember about him. If you met Ernie, he always wanted to make sure that you were good and that you were loved. I'm not going to cry too much because I know I want to celebrate him the way he would want, and that's always to continue and love everyone that you come in contact with and to make sure you leave a good impression on them. I also want to take this time to say that if you don't have a relationship with Christ, I think now is a perfect time to get one. I just want to say that Auntie Gemma, I'm here for you. Jonathan, all the whole family. I want to thank everybody that took their time out on their Sunday. You guys could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here celebrating the life of Ernie. And I want to thank you. And on the part of Ernie, I want to say that I love you and what's going on.
Good afternoon, family. Sometimes package show up at our door and we don't order it, but we cannot take it back. And the only thing we have is to accept it. When I met Ernie for the first time, I didn't even have to say my name. We just clicked at the moment. He was a guy who never afraid to speak his mind and say how he feels, full of love. But death brings separation. And the only thing that left is just a memory. And I pray to God that that memory will last me for a lifetime. To God be the glory.
Sister Charles.
Good afternoon, everybody. I cannot believe that we are here today to say our final goodbye to Ernie. Good day, everybody. I cannot believe we are here today to say our final goodbye to Ernie. As a tribute, I'm going to say a poem. If tears could build a stairway and memories were a lane, we would walk right up to heaven and bring you back again. No farewell words were spoken, no time to say goodbye. You were gone before we knew it, and only God knows why. Our hearts still ache in sadness, and secret tears still flow. What it meant to lose you, no one will ever know. But now we know you want us to moan for you no more, to remember all the happy times. Life still has so much in store. Since you'll never be forgotten, we pledge to you today, a hallowed place within our hearts is where you'll always stay.
Continue singing 6 number 3 3 when we all get to heaven. Sing the the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
This is by far the hardest thing I've ever had to do. But today I greet you with humility and gratitude as we celebrate the life of our beloved Ernesto, Ernie. Some knew him as Tech. He lived life vividly, and he will forever, forever be missed. Ernesto Ernie McDonald was born to Gemma McDonald and Michael Joseph on October 6th, 1980. He grew up and resided in Woodland, St. George's, Grenada. He grew up in Grenada, then later on migrated to the US. He was the husband to Sherry McDonald and the father to Nia McDonald, who was his twin, his heartbeat, his everything. Ernie shared a bond with Nia that was inseparable and unbreakable. And Nia, we know, he is forever in your heart. Our beloved Ernie
was nephew to Christopher, Joey, Donna, Hazel, and myself. He was Hazel and I's Ernie. He was our Ernie. He was Donna's Ernie, Joey's Ernie, Christopher Ernie. He was brother to Janelle, Tally and Chantel. He was best friend to Kimoy and Marcus James Laverman. Ernie will be missed dearly. Ernie's childhood can be best described as happy and adventurous, like any young boy growing up in Grenada. I can clearly remember the time, you know, he knocked his front tooth out. I went to his aunt's job and said, look what I did, smiling without a tooth, and Aunt Hazel almost passed out. I can also recall the time he spent all his school fees that my mom gave him, and then he came home pretending that the principal was talking about the wrong Ernie. That was Ernie. And then one day Johnny, who knows Woburn buses, told me, you owe me some money. I'm like, for what? But Ernie wrote and he said, you'll pay. Of course I had to pay. That was Ernie. Always saying his aunt would pay. But that was Ernie. Carefree, loving. There are countless experiences shared with Ernie, countless memories. And whether good or bad, he would always hold a special place in all our hearts. Ernie has left an impact on all our lives in one way or another. And in death, he has done the same. It would be remiss of me not to mention the way he lovingly cared for and fathered his daughter. Ernie was a father of fathers. You know, the other day I asked Nia what she remembered most about her dad. She said, he was her best friend. He was funny. He listened. And then I said, he spoiled you, huh? And she goes, yes, he did. And spoiled her, he did. Nia, I encourage you to keep strong, because that's what your dad will want you to do. And remember, your dad loved you unconditionally and endlessly. Sorry. As we lay Ernie to rest today, we can only reflect on his life and be grateful for his presence in our lives over the years. Ernie had a special bond with everyone. He loved life. He loved everyone. And today is about Ernie. On behalf of his mom, Gemma, and our family, I would like to express our heartfelt gratitude for the overwhelming and invaluable outpouring of love, support in all forms of prayers, gifts, calls, cards, meals, warm gestures, and everything else in this time of our bereavement. We appreciate every one of you and thank you. We also would like to extend our gratitude to everyone present today to honor Ernie Ernesto. Your presence is a testimony of the life he lived and the people he touched, which is very comforting to us. We thank God for affording us the opportunity to experience Ernie and his contribution to life. He will be missed dearly. I will never be forgotten. Let us all use this experience to love and value each other once more. Value each other, love each other, as life is never certain. Let us never take each other for granted. We thank God because we know Him. Our family knows the Lord. And this time we have leaned on Him like we've never before. May we find comfort and strength in Your mighty each day. Gemma, I love you. And I pray every day for your strength. And all my siblings. Let us all find strength in the Almighty and each other as you accept this loss, as hard as it is. Joe, we have to accept it. And may God continue to bless all of us as we live in love and peace. Thank you. Jonathan, I know it's hard. But Ernie guided you as a big brother. And may that guidance he gave you always remain with you. Skip that part. Hold him in his heart, in your heart, Jonathan. He would always be your big brother in your heart. Thank you.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life, someone could be saved. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets were made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
You can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out. Move mountains, we gon' walk it out and move mountains. And now I'll rise like the day. Silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet. Move mountains, bring it to its feet. And I rise up, rise like the day. I rise up, I rise on a fade. I rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you. For you. like the day I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I will rise a thousand times again. And we'll rise up, we'll rise like the waves, we'll rise up.
Let me say a pleasant good afternoon to everyone. And join with Pastor Z in welcoming us here as you come to pay your last respect to Ernie. I also like to recognize the two men of such high caliber that sit on the platform. To my left, your right, is Pastor Earl Baldwin, who was once pastor. And then we have to the right of me, your left, Pastor Z, who is the resident pastor here, sitting in a congregation with his wife, Pastor Maynard Reed, who once was a pastor here. And I just want to let the family know that yes, we will continue to do whatever we can, whatever way possible, we could reach out to you to be of support to you in this your time of mourning. Bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we give you all the praise, all the honor, all the glory. Even in death, Lord, we can still praise you because we know that death is not the final resting place. We know that you have gone to prepare a place for us and you will come again. And we thank you for coming because when you come, you will come with power that is known as resurrection power so that the dead in you will rise. Give us the comfort and take full control now, we pray. Through Jesus' most precious name, amen. Death. Death and the difficulties of life could always give us reasons why we could blame God. And there are some times we would not probably blame the devil because that's the kind of person he is. The Bible in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 describes him as a roaring lion walking about seeking to destroy and to devour. A roaring lion, which means that he is a deceiver. He causes confusion that will make us see God as one who is a God swift to take life and swift to punish, whereas God is a life giver. God is a life saver. And if I will take you back to heaven, where this whole thing began, we know that the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. But the Bible always also tells us that there was war in heaven. When God, the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, met and decided to create, and they did create, Satan got upset because he was not part of the creation plan. Because Satan knew that whosoever bears the title creator will have to be worshipped. And Satan wanted to be worshipped. So as a result, he created confusion in heaven. Confusion to the point where one third of the angels in heaven saw God as somebody that is not fear. Saw God as somebody that is mischievous. And so God, because of Satan's rebellion, will have to take Satan and the one third and cast him down to earth. But Satan did not stop there. He wanted to make sure that God's creative work was a failure. And so the Bible tells us that when God created Adam and Eve and he placed them in the garden, he would say to them that there is a tree that is in the middle of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat thereof. And we know the story that Eve did go and eat of the tree. It was Satan's intent that when Eve ate out of the tree, that God will end the life of humanity. As a matter of fact, he so influenced Eve that Eve would have taken the fruit and give it to Adam. And as Eve gave the fruit to Adam, I want us to see something here. And as I look at it, it reminds me of the words of the song of one of our children, one of our children's songs. It says, "The devil is a sly old fox. I like to catch him and put him in a box. I locked the door and throw the key for all the tricks he played on me." And that's what, who Satan is. Satan is a trickster. If I will take you with me to Genesis chapter 3 and verse 12. After Adam and Eve ate all the fruit, remember in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27, they were created in the image and likeness of God. But when they sinned, they lost that imagery of God. God had them clothed. While they were created in the image and likeness of God, they were clothed with the very glory of God. When they sinned and they lost that imagery, the glory of God was withdrawn. And you know the story. It says that they realized that they were naked and they went hiding. And then the Bible tells us that God came and he began to call, "Adam, Adam, where art thou?" And Adam said, I saw myself naked and I was ashamed, so I went to hide. And look at the discussion with Adam and God in verse 12 of Genesis chapter 3. He says, "And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I did eat." See who Adam is blaming? Adam is blaming God. Adam is saying, "God, I ate out of it because the woman you gave me gave it to me." Whereas in truth and in fact, it was not God that gave it to her. It was the devil that caused her to eat it. But at no point in the discussion between Adam and God, Adam made mention of the devil. And so it appears here that Adam was blaming God for the woman that God gave him. But God gave him a perfect woman. That corruption which existed through sin didn't come from God. It came from the devil. So if Adam had anybody to blame, it should have been the devil. The devil is a sly old fox. Like to catch him and put him in a box. Lock the door and throw the key for all the tricks he played on me. And then if I will take you to the book of Job. Job was the wealthiest man on the face of the earth during that time. And the Bible in Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2, Satan realized that his intention or his plan to have God obliterate the plan of creation, just get rid of the human race, would not happen. Because when God came and to be able to forgive Adam and Eve of their sins, we know that he killed a lamb representing Christ who was to come. So Satan knew that God was going to send Jesus to come and die on the cross of Calvary. And so one day the Bible tells us, Satan appeared before God. And Satan said to God, "Hey, it makes no sense for you to send your son Jesus to come and die. Because I'm in full control of earth. I'm in charge of us. It makes no sense. He realized that he could not have stopped God with a plan of creation. No, his intent was to stop God from the plan of salvation. His intent now was to stop God from sending his son Jesus to come and die. And God said to him, no, you do not have full control of the entire earth. Have you considered my servant Job? Because Job was faithful. I'm going to stay primarily on this side because of the flowers. If I go there, you may not be able to see me from behind the flowers. But so the discussion began. Satan said to Job, Satan said to God, if I get a chance on Job, I will do something to Job and Job will curse you. And God said, Job is on the earth. And Satan in one day, before I get to that specific day, let me let you know a little of Job's assets. Job had 11,000 animals, 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500, at least 11,000, I should say, 500 yoked oxen, that's those that plow the land, and 500 she asses, the female donkey, in other words, we call them Jenny. But here it is. In one day, a servant came to Job and said to him, while the oxen were plowing the land, and Job had a lot of land. In those days, Job could have been the minister of agriculture. He says here, while the oxen were plowing the lands and the asses were grazing alongside them, the Sabaeans came and they took all the yoked oxen and the 500 she asses, and they killed all the servants that were attending to them. And then another servant, while Job was speaking, another servant came and he said, look, a lightning came from the sky. A bolt of lightning. Brothers and sisters, understand that the devil have enough power to affect and affect the weather system. He says, a lightning came from heaven and destroyed all the 7,000 sheep and all the servants that were tending to them. And while he was yet speaking, another one came and he said, look, the 3,000 camel that you have was taken by the Chaldeans. They formed three bands. They kill all the servants except I'm the one who is able to come and give you the news. And while he was yet speaking, another servant came and he said, all your 10 children were there by the eldest son you have. Your 7 boys and your 3 girls were in the house, and a tornado came and it hit the house, the 4 corners of the house, and all your children died. Brothers and sisters, 11,000 animals and hundreds of servants, and all his 10 children died. What did Job do? The Bible said that Job teared his mantle. He shaved his head and he bowed down to the ground and he worshipped. Calamity cannot come between Job and God, because Job knew that God is not a life taker, he's a life saver. He knew that Jesus will come, and Jesus is not coming to kill, but Jesus is coming to die so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. So therefore the Bible says he knelt down to the ground and he worshipped. Then Job said, naked, I come into this world. And naked, I will go to the grave. The Lord giveth, and the Lord allow that which he gives me to be taken. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so when we are discouraged with the challenges of life, it is not of God primarily. It is of the devil. That's who he is. He is a sly old fox. And as if that wasn't all, but as I think of Job and his experience, I think of a man that is called Horatio Spafford. In 1871, a wealthy lawyer. invested in all the, most of all the properties in Chicago, but in 1871, there is a fire that is known as the Chicago Fire. He lost everything. He had five children, four girls and one boy. Just about the same time he lost all his properties, his son became ill with scarlet fever and his son died. And it was so depressing for his wife and himself that he decided to send her to England on a vacation. And on the way to England, the story tells us when the vessel got to the middle of the Atlantic, it collided with another vessel. And as the vessel collided, brothers and sisters, there was an accident where over 200 persons died. And out of the 200 persons were his four daughters. Within one day, he lost his four daughters. The previous months, he lost his son and his property. And as he decided to join his wife in England, he took another vessel. And the captain of that vessel on which he was knew that Mr. Spofford was there. And when he got to the spot of where the accident took place, he slowed the vessel down so Mr. Spofford could have some memory of his children. And amidst the calamity, Mr. Spofford took a pen and paper and he began to write, "When peace like a river attended my way. When peace like a river attended my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." Brothers and sisters, yes, I know Arnie is dead, but let us find comfort in the word of God, because death is not a final stage of it all. There is a resurrection to come. And as he wrote the song, said, "My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear them no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul." Brothers and sisters, during the time of calamity, it is good to remember John 14, 1 to 3. "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me." In a time of calamity, it is good to remember John 3, 16. "For God so loved the world that he gave the only begotten Son." But the challenges are real, because the devil is alive. And when you look at the experience of Job, the devil went back to God. When he could not have defeated Job to the point where Job will curse God and worship him, the devil, the devil went back to God and he said, "Hey God, you're not playing this thing fair. I've done all I could do, but you're still protecting Job." He said, "Allow me to touch his body." And God said, "Well, Job is enough." And the Bible tells us that the devil went out and used all the power he had. And the Bible says that there were boils on Job's body from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. We have one boil and sometimes it is so uncomfortable. Job had boils on the head. He could not have combed his hair. And not just boils that are boils, but we have different stages of boils. And I hope I don't upset you, but the reality is that there are some person boils. And there are boils that turn sore, so you could imagine the pain he has right through his body. Standing was a problem for Job, because Job, beneath his feet were boils. Sitting down was a problem for Job, because on his buttocks there were boils. Lying down was a problem for Job, because all over his body were boils. Eating was a problem, because inside his mouth and on his lips were boils. Brothers and sisters, when the wife looked at Job and she couldn't bear it anymore, let me look at what his wife told him. Job chapter 3, Job chapter 2. And if you would just bear with me, I could tell you what it is, but I want to read it to you. Job chapter 2. And we'll look at verse 9. As his wife saw him, look at what she says. "Then said his wife unto him, Dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die." Why curse God? It was not God that brought the suffering unto Job. It is the devil that brought the suffering. And I want us to realize, brothers and sisters, if there are two things we must realize, is that the devil is like a roaring lion. He's confusing us to trick us to believe that God is bringing all the calamities, whereas it is him that is bringing the calamities, because God is a loving God, but Satan wants to point God as a mischievous God. So he would say, the Bible says, in all of the trials that Job went through, he did not blame God. Because he knew God was a loving God. But then, his wife asked him the question, do you still retain your integrity? This is who Ernie was. Ernie was a young man who retained his integrity. Honest, trustworthy, loving. It is because of the integrity he retained that he was such a loving father to his daughter. Because of the integrity he retained, he was such a loving husband to his wife. It is because of the integrity he retained, he was such a loving son and brother and nephew and cousin and friend. As a matter of fact, because of his integrity, Ernie was a man who was a leader in the community. And let me say this to us as I look upon us here now. I want to say to us as black men, we must always retain our integrity. And to retain our integrity, we must first involve and to invest in our judgment. Because our minds will determine what we do, and what we'll do will determine who we are, and who we are will determine the character we have. So brothers, as Ernie formed relationship with his daughter, let us be loving to our children. I know there are times that our relationship, or there are times when relationship with our baby's mother, we may discontinue that relationship, but never discontinue a relationship with your children. Never discontinue a relationship with your children. And I say to invest in your minds. We must associate ourselves with positive people. To maintain or to retain our integrity, we must associate with positive people. There are some people that is always going to try to keep us down, but no one who has retained their integrity will be kept down. And when we retain our integrity, as Ernie had retained his integrity, we would always be there to help each other. There is a saying that God will take us from the guttermost and put us to the uttermost, but there are sometimes the hand that God is going to use to take somebody from the guttermost is your hand and my hand. In other words, we must always help somebody as we pass along. And that's who Ernie was. And as a people of color, we must make sure that we invest in our children. And I spoke to the brothers, and I know I'm treading on some very, very thin line here, but sisters, except for some immoral kind of dirty behavior, do not stand in the way when a brother wants to form a relationship with his son or daughter. In the black community, a child needs both father and mother. Except it is for some other kind of immoral behavior we could understand. And brothers and sisters, let us build forces together, because we are living in a racist society. A society of inequality and injustice. And too many of us are fighting each other. The crab in a barrel mentality is not to retain integrity. And we cannot let circumstances keep us down. When Neve sang just now, she said, arise. Yes, I know we have a past of, you know, history where they wrote us in history with the bitter lies and twisted lies. But brothers and sisters, we could always rise, because persons with who may retain their integrity will never stay down. It is Martin Luther King in one of his speeches says, a man could only ride your back as you bend your back. Therefore, we must walk with a straightened back and walk with our heads up high and walk with dignity, because anyone who walks with dignity cannot stay down, because it means that we have retained our integrity. Ernie, at the young age, what, 41? God must have seen it's a time. Listen to me, church. Listen to me, family. God must have seen Ernie at a point where this is the point in his life. Should he be laid to rest now, he will rise in the first resurrection. So always take courage in the word of God. And we learn here today that the devil is a sly old fox. We learn here today that we must always retain our integrity. And when I say that, let me always also say that as parents, when we may retain our integrity, we would not be mainly concerned in investing in what our children wear, but we will be concerned about investing in what they learn. Because economic empowerment could well start with educational empowerment. Are you hearing me? Hi. Integrity. And then I like us to look at Jesus' discussions when Lazarus died. When Lazarus died, the Bible tells us that Jesus was not there in Bethany, and Mary and Martha sent to tell Jesus that Lazarus is sick. And Jesus said to those that brought the news that this sickness is not unto death, but that sickness is that God will be glorified. And I'm saying to us today that this death of Ernie could bring to us a message so that God could be glorified and that our lives could be transformed. Because when they called Jesus, and as Jesus went to the tomb, before Jesus said anything, Jesus first prayed to the Father. Let me read it to you in John chapter 11, verses 41 and 42. Then they took away the stone from the place, because he asked them to take it away, where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, praying, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And then he continues, I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Brothers and sisters, we might be here today to know that God has sent Jesus. And the reason why God sent Jesus is so that Jesus could die, and through his death, we can have life. Because Jesus said, he that believeth in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And the scripture reading tells us clearly, told us clearly how that will happen. In the scripture reading, which Sister Shinaka McDonald read so clearly, it says here, and the Lord himself will descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise. Brothers and sisters, the Bible in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 19 says, from dust thou art, and to dust thou wilt return. Yes, Ernie will return into the grave, and we too will return, and we will turn back into dust. But when Jesus comes with the sound of the trumpet and with the voice of God, something will happen in the dust. Bones will begin to form, and bones will be connected with bones, and on those bones will be flesh, and in those flesh will be blood, and in that blood, in that flesh will be veins, and in those veins will be blood. And the blood, the Bible tells us, is the life of the flesh, and that blood will go into the heart, and man's lungs will contract and expand, because the dead in Christ will rise. And not only the dead in Christ will rise, but Jesus himself will ask death a question. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Brothers and sisters, Job went through the challenges because he looked towards the coming of Jesus. So he said, though worms shall destroy my body, yet still in my flesh I shall see God. And Jesus is coming to take us to a place. And I like the way Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4 describes it. He said, we will dwell with God, and we shall be his people. We will be taken to a place where there will be no more funeral service, no more asking, undertaking service, because there will be no more death. No more sickness, no more COVID-19 virus, no more downstate hospital, no more dialysis center, no more cardiologists, no more high blood pressure. Brothers and sisters, there'll be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying. Amen. For the former things will be passed away. I pray, God, that the rest of the life we have is to form relationship with him. Because not too long from now, each one of us will be in a funeral service. A prayer will be offered, we wouldn't know. Our names will be mentioned, we would not hear it. A song will be sang, and we would not know it. Because the funeral service we will be in will be our own funeral service. In the meantime, let us form relationship with God. And let us, as we live retaining our integrity. And to know that the devil is a sly old fox. I like to catch him and put him in a box.
Amen, amen.
Hello, everyone. I am here to say thank you. Thank you to Elder Calise. Thank you to Ricky Cyrus. He was really a rock for our family. On behalf of Ernie's wife, Sherry, his daughter, Nia, his mom, Gemma, and the rest of his aunts and uncles, cousins, all of us who held him dear and who loved him unconditionally, we want to say thank you to everyone, to the people that called us, that texted, that sent a meal, sent a DoorDash, sent an email, even just sent prayers. We were greatly appreciative of everything. We felt the overwhelming love and support, and we felt covered by your love. In Thessalonians 1, it says, God says, in everything, give thanks. So we want to thank God for the 41 years that we had Ernie. Some of you had him for less. We thank God that he gave us to him. We got to have happy moments, sad moments. We got a lifetime of his with him. And we just want to say thank you to God for holding us during this time, for surrounding us during the hardest time in our lives. I pray that going forward, you would continue to keep us in your prayers, because we really need it. And we will also pray for you. When I was growing up and we were all growing up together, there was a song that used to play on the radio and it said, "Memories don't leave like people do. They always stay with you. And whether they've been good or bad, they'll never be something that you had." And as we keep Ernie's memory with us today, I just want to say to him, to rest easy, nephew. Until we meet again. Thank you.
At this time, we invite the congregation to stand as we sing our ending song, song number 516, "All the Way My Savior Leads Me." All the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread, gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter, and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, lower spring of joy I see. Gushing from the rock before me, lower spring of joy I see. All the way my Savior leads me, all the fullness of his love, perfect rest to me is promised in my Father's house above. When I wake to life immortal, wing my flight through realms of day, this my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way. This my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way.
Let us bow our heads together as we pray. O God, our Heavenly Father, in this sad time, I still want to say what a joy it is to know Jesus. We thank you, O God, for the way you have blessed this family. And the way you have allowed your grace to continue to show to everything. This evening we have been reminded by the preacher of our heritage. We can clearly remember who we are, where we came from, and where we are going. Grant, dear Lord, that each one will use Ernie as a springboard and use this occasion as a time of decision, a time of commitment, a time of planning. And Lord, you will do your part from up there because you are a comforter. You're one who gives us peace that passeth all understanding. Embrace and give peace to this family. And while you do that, let us all respond to your love by agreeing to live with you, so that one day we all will be together in heaven. Thanks for your blessings. Thanks for your promises. And thanks for reminding us who we are. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated.
On behalf of the family, I do want to thank all of you for making yourselves available this afternoon to support the McDonald family here at 634 Prospect Place. Those of you that joined us online, we appreciate your support as well. I'm going to invite the funeral director, Sister Grace, to come forward at this time to give us some instructions regarding tomorrow. The family, as mentioned earlier, there will not be a second viewing this afternoon. So after Sister Grace, I'm going to invite the ushers following Sister Grace to come forward and then dismiss backwards. I know it's you want to fellowship and greet the family, but we are still trying to follow some protocols. So we will ask that you do that in the lobby or in the parking lot, as it is somewhat of a beautiful and temperate day. So again, after Sister Grace's instructions, the deacons will dismiss you. Brother Leon, thank you for being here. And you'll play something sweet, I'm sure, as the deacons dismiss us from the front to the back, to the lobby or to the parking lot. Sister Grace.
Thank you, Pastor. Friends, this concludes the services in the memory of Ernesto McDonald, who will leave here at 9:30 tomorrow morning for Rosedale Cemetery in Linden, New Jersey, where he will be laid to rest. On behalf of his family, thank you again for your many expressions of sympathy and kindness shown to them during their time of bereavement. At a later date, the family will acknowledge your condolences. On behalf of the Erskine Funeral Home, we too extend heartfelt sympathies to the family and friends of Ernesto McDonald. At this time, I would ask that you follow the instructions that were given to you by the pastor. Thank you so much, and God bless you. Thank you.
And if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up, put those down on their knees, and lend a voice to those who cannot speak. If you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. To hold, I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could receive.
is a place for people like you.
I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
Start lesson planning.